I'm Luigi Gagliardi and work as a neonatologist and a clinician in Italy, and I'm also one of the coordinators of the Italian Neonatal Network, which is a network of premature infants participating into the Vermo Nostro network. I'm sorry because I arrived late this morning, so I don't know you. How many of you are clinicians? Marina asked. 1, 2, 3, 4, okay. And the rest of you are epidemiologists? No? What? Sociologist? PhD student, okay. So I think that most of you have read at least a meta-analysis. Is it correct? How many of you read a meta-analysis before? One, only one? Read. Not written, read read a meta-analysis. So about half of you have already read and the half not. And this is about randomized clinical trials, meta-analysis of randomized clinical trials. We have a talk in this afternoon about meta-analysis of observational studies. So first, what is a meta-analysis? Just a terminology question. Meta-analysis is an optional part of a systematic review. It's useful to combine the results of two or more studies, and it's useful to estimate an average or common effect. These systematic reviews can be with or without meta-analysis. Meta-analysis should always be with systematic reviews, although you can do a meta-analysis also without a systematic review. Okay. There are some standard ways to report systematic reviews and meta-analysis, and also how to perform them. This is the PRISMA statement. You can find it on PLOS. It's freely dischargeable and downloadable, and I will follow mostly the Cochrane textbook of meta-analysis. These are the steps of a systematic review and meta-analysis according to the Cochrane collaboration. It's 10 steps. I will not go through all of these because of course doing a meta-analysis, a systematic review and a meta-analysis is a very long thing to do. And I will only touch on the points that probably are more difficult to understand, to become self, to be able to understand without a teaching. First, there is a plan eligibility criteria, which means once you have decided what the meta-analysis should be, that is the point, the step zero, you must decide what type of studies you will look for. Then define the question, we will see this point, plan methods of analysis, search for studies, I will not touch on this, how to perform a bibliographic search, apply eligibility criteria to the studies that you find. So that's most of them typically you will discard because they are not relevant to what you are looking for. Collect the data, assess the studies for risk of bias, or previously it was assessing studies for the quality, analyze and present results, interpret results and draw conclusions, and improve and update review. I will not go through all of this because it's too long, so I'll go through some of the more difficult points probably. So what is a meta-analysis? Is a way to calculate an average, and what it does is that improves the precision of an estimate by using all available data. If you increase the number of studies, if you increase the sample size, we will increase the precision. And please always remember that a meta-analysis by itself, it's an observational study, so that it has all the possible bias of observational studies, like selection bias that we talked before. Why perform? Oops. to quantify treatment effects. Treatment effect is a typical term of meta-analysis. Means odds ratio, risk ratio, risk difference, or whatever it is, you will find very often this term, treatment effects or effect size. The meta-analysis is also useful to increase power, increase precision, but also look at the last 3 points to explore differences between studies. Very often we have lots of studies dealing with the same question, and we know that they end up with different or slightly different answers and results. And performing a meta-analysis is a useful way to try to understand why the studies give different answers. Also settle controversies and generate new hypotheses. I mean, it is not simply, a meta-analysis is not simply a summary of what is already been done, but is also something that points to what has to be done next and why the research is still not conclusive, is not settled. Well, when we can do a meta-analysis? Of course, we can do a meta-analysis if there are more than one study that have approached a certain question. When there are no differences in the study characteristics that are likely to substantially affect outcome. I mean, if all the studies are very different one of another for some characteristics, methodological characteristics, we may not even be able to do a meta-analysis. I think that I received in the mail, I've seen that it has just been published a meta-analysis, I've not read it, I've read only the abstract, on probiotics and excessive crying in infancy. Do probiotics reduce excessive crying in infancy, colics? And in the end, the authors say that they did not perform a meta-analysis because the studies, there are several studies, I don't remember how many they were, they did not perform a meta-analysis because the studies were so heterogeneous that it would have been meaningless to try to summarize them. So that this is one point to remember. The outcome has to be measured in similar ways and are reported, of course. When not to do a meta-analysis instead, as I told you, when it would be mixing oranges and apples, because they were different in comparisons and outcomes or did not address the same question. And remember that if we combine studies that should not be combined together, we will end up with a false idea of precision, a false answer. Another reason is that a meta-analysis is only as good as the studies that are examined. And so, if the studies are biased, the meta-analysis will be biased. Will having a meta-analysis of biased studies will only give more credibility and narrower confidence intervals to wrong results. This is mostly important for meta-analysis of observational studies more than randomized trials, but can be a problem anyway. And if there is this problem, reporting bias, that is that which always happens, that is significant result studies are published more frequently than non-significant one, so that one ends with biased reporting, we will have misleading results. This is again to... Okay, how in practice a meta-analysis is done? First, you must find out the question that you want to answer. For instance, does aspirin increase the chance of survival to 6 months after an acute stroke, or does inhaling steam decrease the chance of a sinus infection? I took this from a Cochrane tutorial. But really, we have to be more specific about the question that you want to answer. And this is the standard acronym PICO. Probably you have already heard of it. Do you? PICO means patients, intervention, comparator, and outcome. Sometimes PICOS, because you can also decide what type of studies. But in this case, we are looking for randomized trials, so that the S we leave it out. Yet the PICO is still useful. For instance, think of a typical clinical question. What is the best empiric therapy for neonatal sepsis? To search literature and to do a meta-analysis, we must translate this lay language question into a PICU and in a meta-analysis language, so that we are able to use all the steps and hopefully try to arrive to an answer. So for the patients, for instance, there could be great difference if you are looking at term of preterm neonates or the age of onset of sepsis, because they are really different diseases, so that probably different antibiotic regimens are the best ones, if a best one exists. The intervention also must be defined. You must select which antibiotic, if it is antibiotic, you want to look for. And which is the comparator? I mean, versus nothing, placebo. For sepsis, is very unlikely that one does a study on sepsis comparing an antibiotic with placebo, but for other diseases, it can be the case, placebo or another drug. And also the outcome can be different. It can be the death. What is the best antibiotic regimen to avoid death, or which is the quickest cure, or when it is necessary to change therapy. We want to know what is the best starting regimen. All of these must be selected in the protocol, and then we have to look for studies that study this. What is usually done is to break comparisons into pairwise, the topic into pairwise comparisons. For instance, this is a hypothetical review: caffeine for daytime drowsiness. Do caffeinated coffees versus decaffeinated? Is there any difference in the outcome? Each review can have one or more. It's not that one meta-analysis must be on single comparison. It can encompass a wide number of comparisons, but you probably have to do this pairwise. And there is a subjective judgment, a subject matter knowledge that dictates and helps you decide what to group together, if it makes sense putting things together or if it does not sense. This is a subjective aspect, but you must know, of course, what you are talking about, what is the meta-analysis about. I would probably not be able to do a meta-analysis on, say, aspirin and the risk of myocardial infarction, because I don't know almost anything about this. While I can understand, if I read and if I try to make a meta-analysis on therapy for neonatal sepsis. A subject matter is always necessary, especially when you use the DAGs, but also in this. Well, this is, we must select also the outcomes. For instance, we could try to see if it is the person is asleep of the end of a trial, or if it is irritable, maybe with the scale, with the score, or if he has headaches, and this changes the way that the results are presented and what we are looking for. Just a little of a part about effect measures. I will discuss only about binary outcomes, that is outcomes that come in either or way. Dead or alive, pain-free or in pain, smoking or not smoking, not continuous continuous measures such as scores or weight or long length of stay or whatever it is. We know that continuous variables can be divided into two pieces. You can say, if you're interested in the length of stay of a child, of a baby, you can always divide this, say, less than 30 days, more than 30 days, and then apply the binary scores, but it's a little bit artificial. Well, we know that there are chiefly three effect measures that are calculated and that are presented: the relative risk or risk ratio, the odds ratio, and the risk difference, or also called absolute risk reduction. These are the three standard ways to present the results. The risk, I will briefly, you know, all of you know about risk, I will be very, very, very quick about this. If you have a close cohort, you know who are the people who enter and you know how many of them get the event. You have 24 people skiing down a slope and 6 of them fall. The risk of a fall is 6 out of 24, that is 25%, or also is also written 0.25. And the risk is number of events divided by the number of people who could have this event. The odds is another way to calculate the same thing. It's slightly more complicated. It is always with the 24 people. It's 6 falls. This time is divided by, not by 24, the people who were at risk, but those who did not present the outcome. That is 6 divided by 18. And this is put as 1/3 or 33%, 0.33. Really, usually the percent way is not used, even though it's the same. Why we say for the risk is 25%, we say the odds is 0.33. In words, the risk of falling were 1 in 4, 25%, and the odds is the chances of falling were 1/3 of the chances of not falling. Or one person fell for every 3 that did not fall. Or the chances of falling were 3-1 against. I think that most people, when speaks of odds, treats them as risks. At least I do. I think of, I know this is not exactly the same number, but I think it's 0.33 means 33 risk. Do they differ very much in terms of numbers? Of this trial, there were people with dyspepsia treated, and out of 164 people treated, 130 still was dyspeptic at the end of the trial. So that the risk was 79% or 0.79. The odds instead, it was 130 divided by those who had not were not dyspeptic, so it was very, very different, 3.8. While the risk stays between 0 and 1, or 0 and 100%, the odds can be from 0 to infinite. This was instead antiplatelets for pregnancy-induced hypertension. And the risk was 4 cases in 63 women, means 4 divided 63 is 0.063, 6.3%. while the odds is very similar, is 6.8%, 0.61. So, just to remember, when the outcome is not rare, they differ much. This is in many studies called the rare disease assumption. And remember that the odds is always higher than the risk, of course, because the denominator is always smaller. The numerator is the same, is 4, and the denominator is smaller. So, if we are studying something that whose frequency is about 10% or less than 10%, they do not differ very much. But if the outcome is quite frequent, more than 10%, they tend to differ quite a lot. Well, let's skip this one, otherwise it's very... think of now, not the risk, but of the risk ratio. We were speaking before, saying that most studies express either odds ratio, risk ratio, or risk difference. So that a risk ratio is a point in this case. This was the numbers. The risk ratio was this one, 0.92, and for the odds ratio, the odds ratio was 0.69. Generally, as I told you, the odds is larger than the risk. And the odds ratio is larger, that means further away from the null than the risk ratio. So that when you see odds ratios, the results always seems more impressive. Very often we do logistic analysis that give us the answer in terms of odds ratios for things that we could treat as risk ratios. This is sort of a traditional way that is very used, even though now the statistical programs allow us to calculate also risk ratios. Is very often they are not presented as such, they are presented as odds ratios, probably also because the results are better to look at. Yes, yes. If you have to do a meta-analysis, you have to take what is presented. Generally, for randomized trials, the risks are available, so that we all often work on risks, not on odds, and risk ratios, not on odds ratios, in meta-analysis or randomized trials. And this is the way they are interpreted. A risk ratio of 0.92 means that the risk is lower in the treated than in the controls. It's about 92 of what would have been in the controls. That is a reduction of risk of about 8%. For this, the reduction of odds is about 30%. Same data, same patients, same efficacy of the treatment, of course. Only a different way to present them. Let's look, have a little look at absolute risk difference, because this is another way to present. The risk is the difference is not a fraction, but is the difference. The risk of treatment minus the risk on controls for the trial on dyspepsia. It's 0.726 minus 0.9793. That is minus 0.76, 67. That is about minus 6.7%. So the interpretation can be that the treatment reduced the risk of being dyspeptic by about 7 percentage points. is no more how much of, but is an absolute number, 7% of the people less of 100 people treated, there will be about 7% less with dyspepsia. When the risk is zero, this implies no difference in effect. That is, if the treatment has no effect, the difference is zero, while the risk ratio is one and the odds ratio is one. I mention this because it's the absolute risk difference. It's the number that we use to calculate the number needed to treat. NNT means number needed to treat. You know this this way to present data? It's the number of people you have to treat to achieve one positive outcome. Maybe it's clear with an example. The antenatal steroids, about half the risk of RDS at each week of gestational age. If you treat 24 weekers, is risk of RDS, respiratory distress syndrome, typical disease of premature infants, is about half that would have been without. If you treat 34, is the same. The risk is always the half of what it was without. The problem with the NNTs is that it depends on the base rate, that is the frequency of the disease in that population. So, for instance, the baseline risk of RDS at 23 weeks is about 100%. That is, all of the 23 weekers will have RDS unless they are treated. At 29 weeks, it's about 50%. These are real data. If you look at the data of real, very preterm infants, you will see that about all of them have RDS at this age, and about half of them will have this disease at this age. And probably at 33 weeks is about 1 in 10. So, can you try to figure out how much it is the number needed to treat at 33 weeks? That is, how many babies have I got to treat to spare one case of RDS? One. Franca says one. The formula is this one. So what is your all of you think that to spare one case we have to treat one baby? No, because it only half. The risk becomes half. It is not taken away completely. If the efficacy was so great that everyone is cured with antenatal steroids, then one would be sufficient. You treat this one and is already the first one that is cured. While you have only half of them, if you treat one, you will have half baby without the RDS. So you have two. And it's very simple, the calculation is very simple. It's about one divided the absolute risk reduction. The absolute risk reduction is the risk without the drug minus the risk with the drug. That is one divided by parentheses one minus 0.5, that is 0.5, that is 1 divided 0.5, 2. So at 29 weeks, remember that the risk is only 50%. So that how many do you have to treat with steroids to save one case of RDS at 29 weeks? 1 divided? Okay. 1 divided 0.25, that is 4. And the 33 weeks is great. I'm very satisfied because this was quite difficult, and you see what happens. The number needed to treat differs very, very much depending of the type of patient that you are looking at. So that is not a constant. It's not a constant across. It's not something that remains constant across populations. What can be true in Italy, for instance, can be different in Germany or in Finland or in Russia or whatever it is. So I would say that you should be wary of number needed to treat and absolute risk differences. They depend on population studies, depends also if you more severe, less severe cases. Especially for meta-analysis, the average absolute risk reduction that you estimate can be a nonsense, yes, something that it has no sense at all. And the last thing that I put is that this is slightly more theoretical, because risk ratios and odds ratios imply a multiplicative risk or protection, while differences imply an additive risk, which means, for instance, that we have two ways to treat respiratory distress syndrome. One is treating the mother with steroids. The second one is giving the baby, say, nasal CPAP. If these two are independent, they will end up to being multiplicative, so that in most of the real situation in life, this model follows better reality than the other one. So that this is another reason to prefer risk ratios or odds ratios over risk differences. Anyway, let's come back to our meta-analysis. We now know what type of number we need. This is the structure. We have several studies that we have already found out through the literature search and whatever it is. And we find the EFT measure, risk ratio, odds ratio, whatever it is. And at the review level, we are here, we must find out a general number. To calculate the summary result, we need either collect the summary statistics for each contributing study, or the total number of patients and the outcome. If you have this information, so much the better. But if you have only this one, you only have the risk ratios reported, you can also use this one with some limitations. So there are several ways that we have, say, three studies, four studies, whatever it is. We want to obtain a meta-analytic number, summary results, a pooled odds ratio, pooled risk ratio. One is to treat as one big study. You sum up all the people with the intervention. We sum up all the people with control, see what happens, just if it were only one big study. But this breaks randomization and will give the wrong answer. I will come to this. The other is to simply average all the numbers. First study say that the odds ratio, the risk ratio is 0.7, the other 0.6, the other 0.8. You simply make the average of 0.7, 0.8, 0.6, and you end with this one. And this also is wrong, because it weights all the studies equally. Some studies instead are closer to the truth. They are more precise. they are not only better done, but more precise. The standard, the correct way, and the standard way to do this is to have a weighted average. So let's explore a little bit these concepts. A simple average gives each study equal weight, which seems probably to all of you wrong, because a big study should weight more. You think that gives more information than a small study. So we exclude this. The other could be, as I told you, just to add all the numbers in one column, the control groups, and all the numbers in the treated groups. And again, this is wrong because it breaks randomizations. So that it's like if we want to come back to epidemiology, this is a stratified analysis. Instead of doing stratified analysis, we do a crude analysis. And this, if you think that there are reasons to stratify, is wrong, because we just do the stratification to avoid confounding. It's like using crude instead of stratified analysis. This is an example of a forest plot. We'll come to this later, with the numbers. You see, each one of these is a study with the number of people with the outcome and the number, total number. This is the treatment and this is the control. You say, in the end, we have 400 people with the outcome among the experimental, the treated, and 300 out of 900 and so on the control group. This is what the meta-analysis comes of in the end. The risk ratio is 0.96. Risk ratio 0.96. While if we simply do this, the risk ratio about this, we end up 1.06. That is about a 10% difference. But this one is wrong, this one is correct. While, when you said that it breaks the randomization, for instance, here we have a number, it's like comparing these 26 events with these 21 events, because we are implicitly comparing all with all without taking care of the randomization. It's no more randomized because the randomization is in this way, but not in this way. For instance, this trial contributes, it's very interesting, contributes 17% of all the data to the experimental column, but only 8%, 74, to the control column. Because there are slightly imbalances, you can end up that if this one has a higher risk, this is about more than 50%, more than 0.5, while the general is about 4. Was less than 0.4, this will contribute more to this one than to this one. If the rate in this group is higher, it will bias the results if we put everything together. We must always preserve the comparison. I don't know if it is clear, but if you think of probably intuitively, it's more clear than after I try to explain. So we must give more weight, we must do a weighted average. More weight to studies that give us more information, that is more participants, more events, and lower variance. And in fact, weight is given to all of these that end up in giving wide in the rule that wide studies with wider confidence interval have less weight. For example, this is a contrived example about the effect of coffee on headache. These are some studies. You see, some of them are bigger. Nescafé is bigger than Amore coffee. And so that we think that we should have more weight. And in fact, the weight in this case is calculated to be 26% of the final average will be given by this study, while this one will contribute only 6%. And it is because of the number of patients treated and of the number of events that gives the variance, and the weights are given according to this. So that in the absence of heterogeneity, and we'll come to this later, the standard weight is an inverse of variance. That is, the weight is given to each study is the inverse of the variance of that study. The higher the variance, the smaller the weight. And this makes sense. That. Well, result sections of review. We have to do a systematic narrative results and then forest plots. Forest plots take the name from Forest of Lines. And you know, this is the logo of the Cochrane collaboration. In a very pertinent way, they have selected the forest plot, which is this one, as the marking of the Cochrane collaboration. So let's look a little bit of these forest plots, because they are presented in a standard way so that we can look at it and see to make sure that everything is clear. This is a forest plot. Very complicated at first, but well, first there is the headings that explain what are the comparisons. Caffeinated coffee, decaffeinated coffee, events and total. Okay, so this column is the events, headache at 24 hours in caffeinated coffee. These are the events in the caffeinated. This is the total treated with caffeinated coffee, and this one is the other one. Here you see always the list of all included studies. These are raw data on which we can calculate the meta-analysis, the summary result for each study. This is total of all studies. Total number of subjects in the caffeinated, total events, total number of studies studied, total number of events. This is the weight that is given to each study by the meta-analysis we saw before. This is the effect estimate for each study with its confidence interval. Look, this is very small. It's IV, means that the method to give the weight was inverse of variance. And fixed means that it's a fixed effect method. I'll come to do this to this later. And this is 95% confidence interval. This is again, but graphically. Each study is given a little blob here. Wow, let's see this one. And two lines that indicate the length of the confidence interval. Remember that we said before, more influential studies, those with greater weights, have smaller confidence intervals. You see, this one has a smaller confidence interval and has more weight. This one, a larger confidence interval, less weight. This line in the middle is the line of no effect. let's say this one, is one. All the studies that whose 95 confidence interval cross this line are, say, not significant at the 5% interval. And this is the scale and direction of benefit of arm. Please look also at the scale. Say one is no effect, because a risk ratio of one means no effect at all. This one is growing, favors decaffeinated. This one is decreasing, decaffeinated. And this one favors caffeine. Look at this scale. Is a logarithmic scale. That is the same distance between 0.1 and 1, from 1 to 10. Or if there was here 100, should have been here. It's not 1, 2, 3, 4, it's 1, 10, 100, 1,000, and so on. So that, why it is done? So that the confidence interval is symmetric across the middle. The same length here that is here, this side. Finally, this is our pooled estimate that we want to find out with the meta-analysis. It is usually expressed as a diamond, and these are the numbers. So instead of having a blob and two lines, we have a diamond. The largest part of the diamond is the point estimate, and the two extremes are the end of the confidence interval. Again, if this crosses the one line, this means that it's not significant, and we should find it. You see that 1.38 gives from 0.96 to 2. This we don't see very well. It crosses, it is not significant. This is another example. That's it crosses, it is not significant. So, let's keep in mind this one about interpreting results, that evidence of absence is not the absence of evidence. A finding a non-significant result does not mean that the two treatments are equal. It's simply that we could not reach a sufficient number of subjects to be sure at 95% confidence that they were really different. And it depends very much on the number of patients treated. If in this example, if you have the same odds ratio, 0.63, but you simply increase the number of studies, that is, you increase the number, you see that this one remains the same until it crosses the difference. So that always remember that finding no significant difference does not mean the two treatments are equal. This is when we interpret, we have done the meta-analysis and found out our pooled result. Always remember that we have to weight up benefits and arms because it's not only a number, it's also something that has to the meaning of this. For instance, if we are doing a meta-analysis on the treatment of acne, if there is even a very slight risk of a serious side effect, this should be taken in greater importance. In meta-analysis, there is a great interest, a great problem studying and trying to understand the quality of studies that they enter. I told you before that if you use rubbish studies, bad studies, you will end up with a bad meta-analysis, and we have to try to find out how to discriminate this point. Instead of quality, now it's best used the term risk of bias. There are some scores you will find out, the Jadad score, for instance, or others, about the quality of studies. For instance, what is the quality related to? Published in a peer-reviewed journal, or what are if the researchers are known or not, if the research was funded by impartial agency. We know, for instance, that clinicians tend to believe more studies that are funded by public agencies rather than studies funded by pharmaceutical companies. There was a paper in the New England, I think 6 months ago, about this. The way we interpret the same data is different according to who funds the study. So that we think that there is either yes or not a conflict of interest. Or impartial researchers, if the subjects were randomly drawn from a population, if treatments were random or not, if there was an attrition, means a lot of people not finishing the study and being lost to follow up. As Marina showed before, this can be a problem. If there was blinding to the treatment, if those who gathered and analyzed the data were blind, and so on. What can we do with such scores? We could use the score to exclude or include the studies, that's all. We say, below a certain score, we exclude the study, we don't meta-analyze it. Another possibility would be to include the score as a covariate in meta-analysis. But the problem with scores is that they are submerge important information because they put together things in an arbitrary way, for instance, the effect of blinding or the funding or something like this, or random assignment, that really should not be put together, or it's arbitrary to put together and give the same weight. Anyway, if we decide to take these studies in performance analysis or not, this should be justified explicitly. And this, in fact, is a qualitative judgment. This is an actual example of Cochrane, which is much simpler, and I give you what the Cochrane suggests us to do. It is just to keep these, I don't know if it is easily readable or not, but the first one is risk of bias, random sequence generation, and the author of the meta-analysis give their assessment of the problem for each study, because the risk was low, because the author say that random sequence generation was by number sealed envelopes containing random computer generated numbers, so that so far as this or this aspect is concerned, it seems that the risk of bias due to lack of randomization was low. The other one is concealment of the allocation, that is blinding. It was adequate. Blinding of participants and personnel. For this one, this is hypothermia, one of the trials of therapeutic hypothermia in newborns for asphyxia. Of course, it is impossible to blind the participants, the researchers, not knowing if one is hypothermic or not, because it's clearly visible. It's impossible to blind. It's not something that you do with the pill, with the placebo, or something like this. So here it has a high risk. It is unavoidable. The reason why we don't speak of quality of studies anymore, and we speak about risk of bias, is just because quality seems a judgment on how well the study was performed. But for instance, in this case, it is impossible to blind the participants to this intervention. So it's not a bad quality study. Is that this study has inherently high risk of bias for this aspect. Blinding of outcome assessment. If you want to know if someone dies or not, probably is not important. If you want to know if it's normal neurologically at 24 months, could be important, because if you know that someone was cooled and you expect that it does better, probably you are more optimistic. So that it could be. And this is an important aspect. Blinding of outcome assessment, OPS, on long-term, short-term and long-term. Incomplete outcome data, if there is lost to follow up. Selecting reporting, and overall risk of bias if there are other questions. So that only these ones are those evaluated by the Cochrane. So that the Cochrane suggests to restrict meta-analysis to studies of low or lower risk of bias. In the end of this, you, for each study, you rate the risk of bias, and you include in the meta-analysis only those who are at low. And we have three possible strategies. Present all studies and provide a narrative discussion of the risk of bias without doing meta-analysis. Here. Do the primary analysis restricted to study of low risk of bias. You just select those of low risk of bias and do the meta-analysis on this. Or the third one is present multiple analysis. You present an analysis with only the studies with low risk of bias. You present another analysis with intermediate high risk of bias, and if you see differences, you think that maybe part of the results depends on biases.
Five minutes.
No, 12.
I see that. Okay, but you have a question at that maybe.
Okay, I can. Okay. Heterogeneity means the fact that that the studies, the same, the studies that investigate the same question can yield different results. This is taken from Ioannidis, and you see here is the cumulative sample size studied. It's a number of studies about 60, I don't remember exactly, 60 different conditions in perinatal and pregnancy medicine. And here is, you see, the number one is the final, let's see, the final effect that was estimated. You see that there is a lot of variation when the numbers are small, and they go towards the final answer by increasing the numbers. And you see these are positive, I mean these increases are greater than the final one, these ones, and these ones are smaller. So this is a very frequent problem. What is heterogeneity? Is the variation between studies results, and of course causes of heterogeneity. That is, the fact that different studies investigating the same question end up with different results can depend on many reasons. For instance, differences in patients, in interventions, type, dose, duration, and so on. If you think of, you want to know if erythropoietin is effective in reducing transfusions. You have a lot of differences in patients, a lot of difference in intervention, meaning that different type of giving erythropoietin, doses, duration, and so on. Outcomes also, and there are also differences in quality methodology, as we saw before. Let's skip this one. How to deal with heterogeneity? We have the possibility again, one, not to pull at all. The second one is to ignore heterogeneity, and this means using fixed effect models or allow for heterogeneity, random effects models, and finally to explore heterogeneity. How you can see if there is heterogeneity in a forest plot? Heterogeneity is the fact that one is here, 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 one is here. You see that they are very different. You end up with a pooled analysis, but you are mixed some who favor control to some studies that favor the treatment. Even though you end up with saying that the treatment is better, you cannot ignore that there is such a high heterogeneity. And you see that after the last two lines in each meta-analysis, report a test for heterogeneity with the chi-square, with the p, and also another figure that is i squared. The chi-square is a test that is performed, is called Cochrane Q. Cochrane is not Cochrane, it was another person. William Cochrane was an American statistician. And has some problems, but because it depends on the number of trials that you study. What I would like to show you is this I2. That is interpretable as the proportion of variation due to heterogeneity rather than chance. So that is quite easy in the end to try to figure out what is happening. That is, roughly, if you have I2 values of 0 to 25% is very low. 25 to 50 is moderate, and 50 to greater is high heterogeneity. This so here I square is 91.8%, very high. Remember, under 25 is very low, over 50 or over 75 is high, and here is high, and is something that we see also by eye. I can skip some of this, but if heterogeneity is very low, you have this fixed, you can use this fixed effect model. If you have high heterogeneity, you should use another slightly different statistical method, that is random effect models, that gives you a slightly higher, larger confidence interval. So, when we have heterogeneity, we can do either random effect model or meta-regression. Meta-regression is the fact that we use if we are able to understand what is the cause of this heterogeneity, we can use this one as a covariate in regression. Well, just finish with some problems with meta-analysis that we have to keep in mind. First, meta-analysis are observational studies. So there is a problem of selection bias. Usually you only use a English language literature, which means that it's not the whole literature. Publication bias, reporting, citation, and so on. This is this is something that is a research from Professor Ioannidis. This is a network of comparisons in randomized trials about antimicotic agents. You see that we have some very big knots, a great number of studies doing done with these agents. And there are amphotericin B, and this is fluconazole. And these are the comparison done. There are 11 studies. He found 11 studies comparing fluconazole to amphotericin B. We know that amphotericin B is quite toxic. Lipid amphotericin B is very effective, but less toxic, but quite costly. Fluconazole is also less toxic and less costly. You see that most of the randomized trials that have been done compare fluconazole with amphotericin B, and amphotericin B with lipid amphotericin B. Put another way, this drug has not been tried very often with against other new drugs. There is only one trial comparing lipid with fluconazole, while most of them compare this one, an old and not very effective drug, with this one, this one with this one. You see that lipid amphotericin B has been tried very unfrequently against other drugs, which means that if we do a meta-analysis, we'll end up with very few data about this drug, because most of the trials are sponsored by pharmaceutical farms. So probably they don't want to, if you are producing this one, you don't want to compare with this one, which is good. You want to compare with this one. So there is a great problem in this. We only can assess trials that have been done. And trials are not a random universe. This is again most striking from Professor Ioannidis. Treatment of pulmonary hypertension. Most of them have been done against placebo. So if you want to compare if it is better sildenafil than bosentan, you have only three trials. While we have a lot of trials with bosentan, with placebo, sildenafil versus placebo, and there are even some, one is sildenafil 2 doses. So that what we are exploring with meta-analysis is very often something that is not so informative. And probably we should, as a community of science, try to increase the number of the information gain in new studies. Publication bias, and I'm almost over, is the fact that it is easier to publish a paper if the results are significant. So that we have more trials around, published by trials that we can meta-analyze, that show a positive effect rather than a negative effect. So if this is true, and it is true, then meta-analysis will yield the results that are biased away from the null, because we are meta-analyzing also more positive trials than not negative trials. So there is one graphic way to see if there is such a publication bias. This is called the Farnell plot, which is this one. You put here the effect size, can be the risk ratio, odds ratio, whatever it is. Each dot is a study, and you put here on this axis according to the size, that is 1 divided the standard error, is again the inverse of variance, so to speak. And you see that you should expect a funnel, reverse funnel aspect, a large base that goes and it should be symmetrical. If you don't see the symmetry, like in this example, this means that here there have been some trials that have never been published. So that our meta-analysis, this could raise some suspicions in us about the results of our meta-analysis. Because we are meta-analyzing most of these ones, that are the published ones, so that we end up with the number here. Instead of being here, it is here. Oh, I don't know if it's clear. I just show you again, this is the what I showed you before. It's a sample size, instead of the one divided, the standard error is the sample size, which is about the same thing, and this is the effect size. You see that there are more on this side than on this side. This is something that always, always happens. By the way, there are more asymmetry in standard meta-analysis than in Cochrane meta-analysis. So that Cochrane meta-analysis that have a very strict methodology are probably slightly better. Well, final is conclusions on this meta-analysis that like large epidemiologic studies, meta-analysis run the risk of appearing to give results more precise and conclusive than warranted, because the large number of subjects contributing to meta-analysis will often lead to very narrow confidence intervals for the effect estimate. I put my email as Patrick did. I have not given the permission to MCA to publish the slides, because most of the slides are not mine, so that I don't want it. They seem that I have, that I take, but if you want them, I can send them to you, of course. You write me an email, I will send them to you. And you can see the handbook. Download the handbook of the Cochrane collaboration. Is quite long, but it contains what I said, and much, much more. Thank you.